On to the seventh meeting in 2016 of the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. Everyone present is please reminded to switch off their phones. Apologies have been received from Rhoda Grant and Peter Chapman, who have used the substitutes Alexander Burnett and Neil Bibby. I would just ask them at this stage if they could make a declaration of any interest to this committee that may come up during the course of the meeting. So, Alexander, could you please lead on that?
I'd like to thank the committee for having me here today. A pleasure to be a substitute for Peter Chapman, given the overlap of many of the subjects with the Environment, Climate Change and Landform Committee, which I sit on. So it's good to see another committee in action. And I refer the committee to my register of interests. Thank you.
Neil.
All relevant interest to the clear.
Okay, we'll move straight on to agenda item one. And that is to take evidence from the Minister of Transport and Islands on the issues within his portfolio, which relate to the committee's remit. It's hoped the session will provide the committee with an overview of the key current and forthcoming projects, policy initiatives and developments within the Scottish Government. So I'd like to welcome the Minister to the meeting. I'd also like to welcome Michelle Rennie, Bill Reeve
and John Nichols, who's a late replacement.
And John Nichols, who I believe is standing in at the last moment. So welcome to the committee. And I would like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thank you for that, Convener. Although you've just promoted me to Cabinet Secretary, but I shan't take that promotion just yet, I don't think. Thank you very much. I'm pleased to be my first appearance at the committee, the Programme for Government. As detailed by the First Minister, provided details on our wide-ranging transport commitments to a growing, productive, sustainable economy with more jobs and indeed fair work. And transport is, of course, very much key to that. So I'll try to focus very briefly, if I can, Convener, on some key areas. In 2016-17, we will continue to deliver a range of network improvements, improvement works through our key rail projects, including the Edinburgh-Glasgow Improvement Programme, the Aberdeen to Inverness line, the Highland Main line, Stirling, Dunblane, Alloa, electrification and the redevelopment of Dundee Station. However, as the committee will be aware, our independent Ernst & Young detailed report, it goes into detail about actually how some overruns are associated with those projects. That is not a situation that I am content with, in fact, one that I'm extremely dissatisfied with, and will be speaking and have spoken to UK Government Railway Minister about that. In my opinion, it's not acceptable a situation that Network Rail are able to overrun these costs without having the levers in my hands, and in this government's hands, and this parliament's hands, to do much about it. In August, I have to say I was pleased, though, to see that the work on Queen Street Tunnel was completed on time, ahead of schedule, in fact, and on budget. This has been an unprecedented project, both in terms of engineering terms and in terms of the scale of operation required to keep people moving and services diverted via the underground platforms during those works. In terms of roads, there's been a substantial programme investment in road improvements and maintenance that will continue in the coming year. £1.4 billion of investment in the road network will include work to dual the A9, the A96, as part of the Scottish Government's commitment within the £315 million Inverness and Highland City Region deal. We're taking forward plans for a single carriageway road connecting Inches and Smithson in the Highland capital. Programme of investment also, of course, includes the completion of the Queensferry crossing, the largest freestanding balance cantilever in the world for a short period of time, which is expected, of course, to be fully open to traffic by May 2017. The M8, M73, M74 motorway improvement project will be complete by spring 2017, and the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route Balmaidie Tipperty project open to traffic in winter 2017. In terms of the buses, Convener, fair to say there are some challenges facing the bus service industry, with patronage over the years having declined. I'm committed to working with the bus operators, with, of course, passengers and commuters, with community transport providers, in order to reverse that trajectory of decline. A part of that will be making travelling on bus easier, and a part of that, of course, is securing that nationwide multimodal smart ticketing. In the coming years, we'll also start work to deliver 3 months free bus travel to those receiving the new jobs grant, as well as free bus travel for modern apprentices aged under 21. In terms of ferries, part of my role, of course, convener, has been travelling around the islands, getting to know Scotland's 93 inhabited island communities. Travelling to these islands has never been so popular. Tourism has increased vastly and greatly. So part of that, of course, being to the rollout of RET. Later this year, we will publish a new study considering potential arrangements to reduce ferry fares on ferry services to the Northern Isles. We've recently published Scotland's first accessible travel framework as well this year in September. And having travelled on the ferries, there's a lot of work still to be done to make our ferries more accessible for our disabled travellers. In terms of that accessible travel framework, those with a disability, I'm sure the whole committee would agree, have every right to have the same travel rights as anybody else. So I'm looking forward to progressing that as part of my agenda as well. And then, of course, there's the environmental challenges that we face. I would say that in terms of transport, we still have work to do in order to ensure that we are also contributing towards the government's efforts, the wider government efforts, to reduce CO2 emissions. And what we are doing is making sure we continue to drive the use of low-carbon vehicles, be that buses, trying to incentivise, of course, the use of electric cars with the rollout of electric vehicle charging points across Scotland. That's a record number that we have across the country, but also maintaining record levels of investment in cycling and walking for the duration of the parliamentary term as well. In terms of update to the committee on a few aspects of the transport portfolio since last June, I would like to point the committee towards the fact that I announced a review of the National Transport Strategy when we had the historic transport summit in Dumfries in Galloway. That review will be completed within the term of this parliament and is much overdue. It will set out the kind of transport network we want in Scotland in 20 years' time, how we will get there, and we will identify the best way to address those strategic challenges and realise the opportunities along the way. On top of that, convener, I would say safety is paramount, and I'll conclude on these points, that safety is absolutely paramount across the transport modes that we use, and therefore a lot of work, a lot of detail, a lot of attention of mine is going into making, in particular, our roads safer. Figures last week showed that road casualties reported to the police in 2015, the casualties fell by 3% between 2014 and 2015, the lowest number since records began. Road deaths down 42% compared to the 2004-08 baseline. But I think it's fair to say that, again, the committee would agree that one fatality on a road, in fact, one fatality is one fatality too many, particularly where young lives are involved. So we'll be supporting the members' bill that proposes to ensure that seatbelts become a legal requirement on all dedicated school transport in Scotland. The winter service that I launched, the winter preparedness launch earlier this week, convener, that of course is to ensure that during periods of difficult weather and challenging weather, that our roads are maintained safely, people travel safely, and of course that we mitigate any disruption. And for the first time this year, there will be the ability to monitor gritters live as they go around the country, treating roads on our trunk road network, which I think will allow people to plan their journey well ahead and well in advance. The very final point I would make, convener, is that certainly the transport job comes with its challenges. Some of those we're seeing, and I'm certain we'll talk through some of them in terms of ScotRail's performance, which I don't find to be at an acceptable level. Challenges across the portfolio. But if we get transport working and working for the people of Scotland, the businesses of Scotland, the communities of Scotland, then actually we can help our economy grow, but also tackle some real issues around social isolation, around deprivation, about that inequality that exists in our country. So I'm committed to do that. I'm, of course, welcome the opportunity to take questions and hear some feedback from the committee. But I thank you, convener, for this opportunity.
Minister, if I could say at the outset that this meeting was set up with the expectation that the review of the major rail projects would be available to the committee. Unfortunately, well, fortunately, you have managed to give us the executive summary only. We haven't been able to see the rest of the report, which I believe is to be published this afternoon. We've also received correspondence from Network Rail as late as last night prior to the committee meeting. So the questions that you will be asked by the committee will be in the knowledge that we are basing those questions on the executive summary that you provided us, but with the disappointment of not having the ability of to consider the whole report. I think the first question on this and is going to Stuart.
Thank you, convener. Since I'm going to be asking questions about rail, let me just make my declaration of interest that I'm the Honorary President of the Scottish Association of Public Transport and the Honorary Vice President of Rail Future UK. These are in my register of interest. If some of the questions I asked appear to be outside the remit of those who are attending committee, or indeed answered in the report that we haven't yet got, it would be helpful if either of the questions could be answered later in writing or referred to this afternoon. Let me just start. I want to start by looking at how Network Rail manage projects, or perhaps at the shortcomings in their doing so, and perhaps ask an obvious standards thing, that companies that deal with government, and I've experience of this, normally have to be qualified to the quality management standard ISO 9001. Is that the case where Network Rail are working with government?
Thank you. And just to address the convener's point, if I may, I will look into the reasons why the report wasn't given to you in advance. But of course, when that report, full report, is given to the committee, if the committee wishes to call me back, of course, I would be amenable to that. Or indeed, if you were to write questions to me, I'll make sure they are answered. The executive summary really provides a good level of detail on what the full report has to say in that regard. In order to the member's question, I will look at the exact intricacies of what he's asking, but I would say this much. That is somebody who has taken up the job in the last 5 months, I'm astounded at the lack of leverage, control that the Scottish Government, Parliament, and indeed this committee has over Network Rail, even though, of course, it's Scottish taxpayers' money that is going into these major rail infrastructure projects. That is why it would be hardly a surprise to the member that I would call for the full devolution of Network Rail and indeed the devolution of particularly the infrastructure projects. The fact that in the centre in London, network major rail infrastructure projects are for Scotland are decided, are the discussions around the development, the design, all happens in that corporate centre. You know, I don't find an acceptable situation whatsoever. So long as Network Rail stay within this debt cap that is agreed between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, there is very little that can be done. That was detailed in the Ernst & Young, the independent report, which talks about the fact that Transport Scotland and by default the Scottish Government lacks effective commercial leverage to penalise or reward Network Rail to drive project performance. You know, that is not an acceptable situation to me. So I've raised it with the UK Government Railway Minister. And I know, in fairness to the UK Government, they're facing the same issues. And in fact, to a worsening degree, whereby the debt cap has been breached, and therefore projects have been cancelled and scaled back. Now, we're not at that stage. But for me, the reclassification of Network Rail has thrown up some challenges that haven't adequately been dealt with.
Well, just since the Minister mentioned reclassification, can I just ask a financial question? Does that affect the operation of the Barnett formula now that it's no longer independent of government but in the government's balance sheet?
I've asked that exact question to the Railway Minister, to which, because we need certainty, of course, going into the next control period of how future rail projects will be funded. So I asked the UK Government Rail Minister, Paul Maynard, that exact question. Can we get some certainty over how we'll be funded in the future, considering reclassification? I have not, as of yet, had an answer to that. But in fairness to the UK Government Minister, it was the meeting was last week, and he's promised to write to me on that issue, and once he does, I'm happy to share that with the committee.
Well, let me just return, Minister, briefly to the subject of standards. I referred to ISO 9000, 9001, which are quality management standards. There is also ISO 21500, which is the project management standard. It's comparatively new. If you're not aware of the answer to this, can I at least encourage you to press the UK government to require ORR to adhere to those standards or some other publicly auditable standards so that we have a baseline against which their project management performance can be measured and against that which those who do conform to those standards is measured.
I'm certainly happy to have that conversation with both the government and also the ORR. It's fair to say that Network Rail's insistence is that many of these projects have overran because of compliance issues. ORR completely disagree with without putting words into the ORR's mouth, of course, do not accept that there has been a difference in compliance standards that they've requested from Network Rail. Whereas with my meetings with the chief executive and the chair of Network Rail, they suggest that there's been some difference in terms of the requirement for them in terms of compliance. So there is a disconnect between what is being said by or what has been said to me by the ORR and what has been said to me by Network Rail. But I think the suggestion that the member makes in terms of a standard that should be acceptable across all the stakeholders who are involved in major rail infrastructure projects is an eminently sensible one.
Specifically, we are where we are just now. How is Transport Scotland seeking to manage, in the context that we have, the major network, the major rail enhancements that Network Rail are responsible for, particularly in the light of the concerns about delays and increased costs?
That's key to the recommendations in the report, and one of some of those recommendations we've already started to take forward. So having a major rail projects board across the portfolio is key to that, and that will look at each of the projects in the control period, look through the governance, look through where there might be potential slippage, issues, obstacles, and make sure that Transport Scotland and indeed myself have overview of that. And so that's what we will do. That's one of the recommendations. There are many recommendations and in the report, and fair to say that we welcome and accept all those recommendations that are in the independent report. For me, there is still a question mark, though, over how much leverage we can have when Network Rail is not directly accountable to this government, this parliament, and indeed this committee.
But nonetheless, Minister, while we may lack the leverage at present, are you satisfied that we're in a position to identify the shortcomings so that we can make others aware of those shortcomings and through others exercise leverage if we cannot directly do so ourselves?
Yes, I am. And let me make it clear, although Network Rail infrastructure projects are not devolved and I will be seeking that devolution, that does not mean at all that I will tolerate any further slippage, be it in terms of additional costs and timescales. So that pressure is being put on Network Rail. We will, of course, work closely with them, with other stakeholders, to ensure that we get best value for money for the Scottish taxpayer. And absolutely, the member is correct. The lessons that we've learnt here and that are summarised in the executive summary, but also detailed in the full report, are ones that we'd happily share with partners across the United Kingdom. And that is the point. This is affecting the compliance issues, the electrification issues are not unique to Scotland by any stretch of the imagination. They've had serious impacts on rail projects right across the United Kingdom.
Sorry, I'm just going to give you a wee break from Stuart at the moment, because I know he's got other questions that he wants to ask that are coming on here. Could I ask you, Minister, a question? With the reclassification of Network Rail in 2014, the ORR did an executive did a report in October, which was published in October 2015. It intimated they had written to Network Rail in March 2015, and it was clear that Network Rail were missing milestones. 36% of their milestones that were laid out were missed. And they went on to raise various issues. No doubt that you will have seen this report and acted on it. Could I ask you what monitoring Transport Scotland has done to ensure that these milestones were being constantly monitored. I mean, to me, it seems that if, as a client, that if things aren't being achieved, that you put in extra monitoring. And I'd like to know what extra monitoring was in place and what extra reporting there was to the Minister, please.
I thank the convener for the question. Egypt would be an example of a project where there was additional monitoring, and I'll get the detail to the convener, of course, in that. But effectively establishing a client group, being involved in the and chairing a project board of Egypt, allowed Transport Scotland to have more of a say and indeed closely monitor how that project was developing. I think that gives us a good example of what we should be doing across our major rail projects. Now, that wouldn't have stopped and hasn't stopped cost overruns from happening. What frustrates us is the delay in information being communicated from Network Rail about potential slippages, about potential compliance issues, potential issues with electrification, coming far too late in the day to Transport Scotland, as you quite rightly say, as the client, to be able to act on it. That, to me, is not an acceptable way of working, and I've said that to Sir Peter Hendy, to Mark Carn, the Chief Executive of Network Rail, that closer lines of communication are absolutely key. I think there is an attitude there within some elements of Network Rail that so long as they're not breaching the debt cap, then actually overruns are just a natural part of what we do.
In fairness, I understand what you're saying, but you know, in a commercial world, if you see milestones are being missed and errors are being missed, it's beholden not to rely on the supplier to supply the information. It's on you to get the information from the supplier. Now, we had an example, I think, that was given to the committee on one of the bridges where there was some European designation on whether the bridge had to be, or a gantry had to be inches higher, and they delayed on making the decision, which caused an overrun. And what I want to know and what I want to understand is that the government and the ministers responsible for this are actually paying close attention to the detail, because it's fine to blame the person at the bottom, but sometimes the blame must start at the top. And I wondered if you had a comment on that.
I mean, I think absolutely in terms of Transport Scotland, there are things that we can do to ensure that we are monitoring closer every single project and closely every single project that is being funded by Scottish taxpayers' money, hence why we have established that projects board portfolio wide. But we do rely on Network Rail as the contractor to ensure that when they give estimates, that those estimates at design stage, at developmental stage, are well detailed. And the fact that years on they can come back and say that compliance issues that I think, not being a transport expert, but I think they should have been cited on these issues well in advance at design stage, at early stage, to come back years later to say that that's now costing an extra X million pounds. I don't find that an acceptable situation. So yes, we have, in fact, I would go as far as saying that if it wasn't for Transport Scotland and indeed the Scottish Government's interventions, realising that things weren't going as well as they should have been on Egypt, that we wouldn't have got to this position of having this report, of having this information detailed to us about where the cost overruns are happening. That to me is not an acceptable situation. Let me make that absolutely clear, convener, from the offset. I don't find what has just happened, what is detailed in this report, to be an acceptable situation. Yes, there are improvements that Network Rail most certainly have to make. I think there's questions there for ORR. But if the question is, are there things that we can do in Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government better, I would say absolutely. Hence why we're taking some action in terms of, as I say, that portfolio-wide project board.
I just want to, on the final part of the executive summary, if I may just quote it to you from the AOR, is that on the basis of our findings, we cannot be satisfied that Network Rail is doing everything reasonably and practical until the EIP is sufficiently finalised and there's evidence of the improvement based on the EIP. Could you confirm to me that you were satisfied, or that the government was satisfied that it was finalised and that the improvements were appearing? Because if they're not, then the report of the AOR doesn't seem to have been actually actioned on.
No, look, I'm confident that the measures we've put in place will give us a greater level of scrutiny,
will allow us to monitor much closer each of every single one of those projects. If you're asking me, do I absolutely nail my colours to the mast and that each of these projects will be done on time without any further delay, without any slippage, the work we've undertaken to do that should mean that these projects come in on time, come in within the new budgets that we are discussing with Network Rail. But until I have full devolution, till we have leverage over Network Rail, there's no way that I can absolutely make that confirmation.
Stuart, do you want to come back with that?
The project board is a key part of what oversight we're going to have in future. One of the things that appears is that a lot of the problems arise from failures to understand the technical issues associated with projects on the part of Network Rail. Has our project board here got the capabilities to engage at that technical level and understand the issues early enough to rein in and control Network Rail and to interact in a way that will make things better in future?
Yes, I'll ensure that it does, but I don't think the problem was that the engineers didn't understand that certain compliance issues had to be adhered to. I think there's some serious questions and the recommendations in the report reflect this around the project governance and what was being listened to from the engineers, what was done in past projects being applied to future projects. And I think in around governance is where a lot of these issues can actually be addressed. So I don't think the knowledge of Network Rail engineers, I'm not saying that the member's suggesting that, of course, but it's not the knowledge of the Network Rail engineers which was the issue. People know about the compliance issues that the ORR and the compliance specifications that the ORR sets out. It's our job now and with the Major Rail Projects Board to ensure that those compliance issues are factored in early as possible into the developmental stage of major rail infrastructure projects to avoid this situation from happening again.
I suppose the final question that touches on all this is, given that there's cost increases in the projects we're undertaking, is that going to diminish our ability to undertake other rail projects?
Of course, it's within the debt and borrowing cap that's agreed between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, and that hasn't been breached, and there is some headroom despite the cost overruns as identified by the report. There is still some headroom, but of course, as the member alludes to, that does have an effect on future budgets. So to say that it wouldn't have any effect would be absolutely incorrect. It will have an effect on future payments as we do the debt repayments. So yes, there's the possibility that, of course, it will have an effect on future budgets. How that manifests itself, of course, will be a discussion for future spending reviews and future discussions.
I have a two more questions, if I may. One is on the executive summary that you kindly gave us. Can I ask you to identify... there are various things identified in there regarding attitudes and the way things are reported to Transport Scotland. I'd like to push you on how you are going to combat those now that they've been identified.
Well, as I've said, the first thing we've done, which is, we haven't waited and wasted any time, is that Major Rail Projects Board, which will look at projects, not just one project in isolation, but look at the scope of the projects. Across, it will be for me to examine the report in detail and work with Transport Scotland about what we can do. But certainly, having a closer relationship with Network Rail will be absolutely key, despite the devolution discussion and the argument. Having a closer relationship with Network Rail, understanding. Also, I think for future, if I may, convener, one of the most important lessons to learn is how we do our H loss and control period. Process in the future. I don't think the way that it's done currently is suitable for Network Rail as a reclassified body. So asking for early cost estimates years and years and years before a project is even near construction, and then being surprised when there's cost overruns, for me is not a sensible way of moving things forward. So immediately I'm instructing a review of how we do our H-loss process for the future control period 6 and control period 7. So I think there has to be a better way of doing it. And having had that discussion actually with the UK Government Railway Minister, we barely diverged from our opinion that the current way of doing major rail infrastructure projects simply isn't suitable for the circumstance we find ourselves in now.
That neatly leads me on. Do you have a timetable for that review, and when we can expect to be seeing the next period of the next tranche of HLOS being put forward for the Parliament to look at?
No, I'm discussing that at the moment with Transport Scotland, but once we define a timetable, I'm more than happy, of course, to write to the convener and make sure you have that.
I think it's important that we understand that programme so we can start to monitor it.
Okay.
Were there any other questions? Because Gail would like to ask a specific question without getting too much tied into a constituency issue on the far north line.
Good morning, Minister. Wouldn't be me if I didn't ask you a question about the far north line. First of all, I'd like to draw the committee's attention to my register of interest, where I state that I am Vice President of Friends of the Far North Line. ScotRail's recently published the Performance Improvement Plan, and it mentions the possibility of timetable adjustments on the Far North Line. Now, this either fills me with dread or fills me with hope, given the fact that currently Inverness to Wick takes 4.5 hours. Can you ensure that there will be no further timetable degradation, particularly with an increased journey time on the Far North Line as a result of this?
As a member would know, timetabling, of course, is a matter for ScotRail, but I will certainly press the case with ScotRail. In my opinion, the performance of the Far North Line has not been an acceptable standard at all. I've seen the performance figures. And having spoken to those involved in Friends of the Far North Line, they feel that they're neglected and have been neglected in terms of train services and rail services. And I can understand why they would feel that that is the case. Having spoken to ScotRail about the performance of the Far North Line, I have an assurance from ScotRail that they understand that the performance on the Far North Line has not been an acceptable standard, and therefore are keen to work with stakeholders to improve that. So I'll certainly communicate that message. I don't want to see any further diminution, any further degradation, or indeed any further, any more delays to the Far North Line, and I'm happy to press that with ScotRail. I am, I think, at the members' insistence, due to meet with Friends of the Far North Line in the coming period. So I will be looking forward to hearing from them about some of the improvements that they think can be made to that line.
Thank you for your answer. We also have the Network Rail Scotland Route Study, and they laid out 4 key interventions for the Far North Line, and I know that's something that Friends of the Far North Line will be bringing up as well. Can I get an assurance that you will at least give these some consideration?
Yes, I'm open-minded to them, and I know some of them, and indeed other MSPs, in fact, even some of those around the table have mentioned some of those improvements. And look, as we go into that control period 6, notwithstanding what I've just said to the convener about how we do things differently, I think presents an opportunity for, obviously, future investment in our railways, and the Far North Line should absolutely be part of that consideration. So, no, I'm not closed-minded at all. But at the same time, the member will understand there are competing demands in terms of investment in our railways, and therefore I'll have to weigh those up with the cost and the benefit that they might bring.
Thank you.
Okay. I've also written to the Minister about cancellation of trains on North West lines, where they go through and don't stop at stations, which, if I get more than one letter on that, and I'm sure with the deputy convener and John, I'm sure we all get letters on it. And I would ask the minister just to bear that in mind. It's very frustrating if you go past the station without stopping that you're trying to get out at. Anyway, on that note, the next question is on Borders Railway and is from John.
All doing constituency stuff, I'll just mention the cuts on the Airdrie-Bathgate line have not been acceptable. However, my questions are on Borders Rail, and I've got 3 points, I think, to make on that. Now, Borders Rail, I think everybody accepts, has been a big success, but there have also been some challenges along the way. So maybe to start with the challenges, 2 of the points that have come up, and I also co-convened the cross-party group on rail, so we were looking at it there again. But 2 of the challenges or criticisms have been that the rolling stock was far too old and was never going to be suitable for this line. And, well, would you accept that and what's going to happen about it? And secondly, that there was a considerable cutback in the number of double-track sections that there could have been on the line. And that means that if anything does go wrong, it is very hard for ScotRail to recover from it. So, I mean, on these two points, can you give us any comment or reassurance?
Sure, I can. I think the first point to make is the opening remark from the member that the Border Railway has been a success. And we had a members' debate yesterday led by the constituency MSP for part of the line, of course, Christine Graham. About adopt-a-station scheme, and every member that spoke across the political divide started the remarks by saying that the Borders Railway has been a great success. A million-plus passengers in its first year. We know that, of course, the establishment of the Borders Railway was the longest new rail line in a century. 50 years of campaigning from those grassroots campaigners to reopen that line. So it has been a real, real success, notwithstanding that success, of course, there have been performance issues. And ScotRail, fully aware of those, and I asked at the time for an improvement plan on that, and that is already very much underway. In terms of the specifics of what the member asks, for the Scottish Government's perspective, we put forward the specifications on what we expect in terms of a new rail service, in terms of the frequency of that service. It's then for ScotRail, in this case, who of course won the bids, and ScotRail to procure the appropriate rolling stock. And what I would say about the 158s, yes, there has certainly been issues. A lot of those issues have been because of the radiators involved in the 158. Therefore, when going up the steeper gradients, particularly on hot days, getting hotter, overrunning, and then causing issues. And again, yes, I accept what the member says. These things should be considered, and ScotRail should have considered them. Now, they accept that the performance on the Borders Railway, again, hasn't been to the standard that we expect as a government and that they expect of themselves. So already they've started some work on improving some of that. So some of that work includes, well, actually work to the radiators. So, you know, making sure that that technology is updated, removing any blockages and so on and so forth. Also, every train will be met on the platform by an engineer, so it can be looked at there and then. And a £14 million worth of refurbishment and improvements on the actual rolling stock and the infrastructure is going to be incredibly important to driving up that performance, because we can focus on the rolling stock, which we should do to an extent, but also some of the performance issues related to, for example, axle counters, signalling problems and signalling issues. And these are being addressed as we talk. And again, from the members' debate yesterday, not to hopefully misquote, but Christine Graham made the point, as did, I think it was Rachel Hamilton, MSP, that in the recent month and a half, they feel that the Borders has been improving. They've had less in their inbox. Now, that's anecdotal from those MSPs, but the improvements that Network Rail, ScotRail, have put forward, I think, are starting to bear some fruit, but I'll be keeping a close eye on that. The second point the member spoke about was to do with double tracking and so on. And I read an interesting article from David Spavin, the rail consultant, on this very issue, actually. And he was critical, as some others have been, of the forecasting methodology that we use and that Transport Scotland use, and saying that actually, you know, if it was predicted that there was going to be this many passengers, the layout of the rail line might have been different. And I've taken that on board and asked the team to review the forecasting methodology. And I think in some rail projects it has worked, but clearly in some parts and Borders Railway, some of the estimates were way off. Now, forecasting, as the name suggests, obviously is not an exact science, but there should be, the amount where some of these figures were off were, to me, disturbing. So I've asked for a review of how we do forecasting in the future. Moving forward, again, in the same discussion I just had with Gail Ross, MSP, where there are improvements that are suggested to the Borders Railway. So I've met with the campaign for the Borders Railway. They've suggested some passing loops and where they think double tracking might well improve. I am open-minded. We have a control period coming up, again, the HLOS process. So I'm always open-minded to that and continue to have discussions with relevant stakeholders about how we can improve that performance.
Thank you for that. I mean, you touched on then what was going to be my second point, which is about the forecasting, because it appears to have been got, and it does seem to be a regular occurrence, or the feeling is that it's a regular occurrence, that when we look at a project, the number of passengers using a line has been regularly underestimated. And I think that was true in the Airdrie Bathgate line, where it's been better, and I think it's been true in the Borders. I know individual stations don't always meet expectations, but the overall level seems to be. So, I'm encouraged that if the Minister's saying that, because it seems to me that other future projects might be held back if there's an underestimate in passengers. Plus, you get the problems on the Borders that it can't actually cope with the number of passengers.
I think that would be my concern as well. I mean, I would share the member's concern. And I get it. I get communities up and down Scotland putting forward their case for their railway infrastructure project that they want to see in their communities. And each of them are as passionate as the campaign for the Borders Railway. And for me, it would be wrong if we dismissed them because our forecasting methodology was really far off. So that's why I've instructed that review to take place. Again, I just want to reiterate, forecasting, of course, is not an exact science by the very nature of it. But I think there's some lessons there to be learned. Notwithstanding all of that, I would like to reiterate that Borders Railway has been a great success and something that I think all of us should be celebrating.
So my final, third and final point, it has been a success, we've got more passengers wanting to use it, so one of the answers has to be longer trains. Can you give us any timescale when we might get up to 3-car trains instead of 2-car?
Yes, we're increasing capacity on that line as electrification progresses and the cascading of rolling stock across the network takes place. So, for example, we're already investing in refurbishment of the trains, but for peak services next year, in 2017, we'll see some additional capacity. And then as electrification continues, we'll see additional cascading of the rolling stock across the network, which will improve capacity. But certainly by next year, we'll see some, at peak times initially, some increased capacity on Borders Rail. But the member makes the point that the success should be a driver to ensure that continued numbers can use the line.
Thank you. I just ask as a follow-up on that, if I may, just as well. Have you set yourself a target date when you can see whether there is quantifiable improvement in the near future so you can report back actually to the committee and to, specifically to John on when the improvements will be achieved?
Convener, I monitor PPM figures daily. I mean, I look at them every day. Go online. I look at the improvement, where it has been made, where it hasn't been made. I think... For the improvement plan across the network as a whole, and committee will be aware, and I expect questions on the improvement plan that ScotRail have put for the network as a whole. I'm looking towards the end of the year to give ScotRail some time. Now, they've put forward the improvement plan. They understand the strength of feeling that I have on their performance, and they understand the serious consequences if their performance doesn't improve. But it would be remiss of me not to give them the time to put forward those improvements. I will do that, and I will update the committee if they wish on whatever regular basis they wish to have that update on. But yes, we are anecdotally from the MSPs, constituency MSPs in that area and the Border specifically, seeing some improvement, not quite at the standard I would like it to be at.
Okay, thank you. We're moving on to ScotRail performance. Which you, as you say, have made it abundantly clear, I think, in a piece on STV that was picked up this morning. I think Mike has some questions for you.
The ScotRail Performance Improvement Plan, which was mentioned as we haven't received, actually, we haven't received the ScotRail Performance Improvement Plan. What we've received is a summary, and I asked the Scottish Parliament Information Centre to make sure we get a full copy of this, and their response was, and I quote them, "You asked if Spice could obtain a copy of the full report of the Performance Improvements Plan sent to Transport Scotland by ScotRail. Only the summary document is available." Now, you said in your opening remarks that you don't find ScotRail's performance to be at an adequate level. Now, we can't do our job on this committee if we don't see the material, the report that is sent to you. And I quote from the summary which we have in front of us from Phil Verster, the managing director. He's saying, "Our train service punctuality and reliability has moved from just above 90% to 89.6% in recent months, That drop of just under a percentage point is why Transport Scotland have asked us to produce this plan to bring it up to the level they and we expect it to be. I find that astonishingly complacent, and it doesn't chime with the comments that you've just been making to the committee now about how you don't find this performance acceptable. Phil Verster, in his these remarks I've just quoted, seemed to be suggesting that the only reason that you've asked them to produce this report, which we've only got the summary of, is that this fall of 0.4% in punctuality and reliability is the only reason it's been done. I just can't understand why we haven't got this information that you have got.
Let me try to give the member some reassurances if I can, because I think he actually raises some very valid points. And in terms of the improvement plan, the fact that it's published, which is not the norm practice, I should say, the fact that the campaigners, MSPs and others have called for it to be published, a version of that has been published. Now, the reason why the information that hasn't been published, I will check for that. I'll check if it's commercial confidentiality or sensitivity. I will check and I will come back to the member. But the point is that improvement plan that is online does detail the improvements that ScotRail are going to make. They are the key improvements that we expect ScotRail to make, some of the key improvements that we expect ScotRail to make to improve performance. But let me try to delve deeper into the point that the member makes, which I think is a very, very valid one. That, of course, the contractual obligation is to meet specific PPM targets throughout the franchise, and those increase year upon year. And PPM, again, I'm sure as the member aware, is that measurement of trains arriving at destination within 5 minutes of a timetable. That is one measure. And statistics certainly are important, of course, because they help us to measure that performance. But all I have to do is look at my Twitter feed and see where people are complaining largely, for example, about capacity issues during peak hours. And, well, of course, capacity is also measured. That doesn't necessarily chime with PPM. PPM is a measure for punctuality and reliability, as the member knows. But then there's also issues around capacity. So what that plan details is not just how there'll be improvements to the PPM figure, which is important, but actually how we'll also ensure that we'll do work around the capacity issues, which are making commuters' journeys uncomfortable. So having spoken to ScotRail, they're under no illusion the strength of feeling that I have that their performance is not an acceptable situation. And there are serious consequences, of course, if that does not improve. So PPM is part of that. It's a measure, but it isn't, for me, the only measure of success and indeed of a good commuter experience on our railways.
Camille, what I'm frustrated about really is that we're hearing what you're saying to us now, which is fine as much as that you're not satisfied with ScotRail's performance. I've got quotes from you in the press which you indicate that very strongly. Yet what I can't square in the circle is when Phil Verster, the managing director, has produced this summary of the ScotRail Performance Improvement Plan, and he is actually quite clear, as the point I'm making, is that he is under the impression, from what he's actually saying, what I've read out, that he's only been asked to produce this ScotRail Performance Improvement Plan because his company has failed by 0.4%. That's what he's actually said in the it doesn't square with what you're saying to us now. And I want to make sure that the message what you're giving to us is being given to ScotRail.
I think, again, the member, you're raising a very valid point. I can't speak on behalf of Phil Western and ScotRail, but I can say from the discussions I have with him, he understands that this is not just about PPM. So, for example, when I went to Atrium Court, the ScotRail offices in Glasgow, I was taken into a room, what is often called a control room, which is there measuring a variety of different criteria about the passenger commuter experience, from capacity to the cleanliness of toilets on the train, right the way through to PPM figures. And of course, some of the recent investment that we've made in rail, when the government announced £100 million capital stimulus, £3 million of that coming to our railways, was not just about performance, PPM, improving PPM, although that is important to us. Some of that is about addressing the capacity issue. So Phil Verster, I would say, without, again, putting words in his mouth, I think is very much aware that not only do I expect them to reach the PPM target, which is important, it's a contractual obligation, so I don't want to go away from that, and they're not far off it. It's still going to be a challenge, I have to say, with an autumn-winter period coming up to meet their contractual obligation, which you would understand would be one of my priorities, to ensure that they meet that contractual obligation, because that is why we give them the money to run our railways. But aligned with that, Phil Vester understands and ScotRail understand that I expect immediate and medium-term and long-term solutions to the capacity issues, which are frustrating so many commuters every day. So some of that is already being done in terms of the additional trains coming on the Glasgow suburban route, and indeed future plans for high-speed trains coming. So if I can give the members reassurance, it's not my belief that ScotRail are complacent about this. They understand the seriousness which have made this approach, and they also understand the seriousness of the consequences if that performance doesn't improve.
I have one small point to that, Convener. I mean, we mentioned the Borders Railway. If I can just one example. I mean, I travel up to Aberdeen, and the trains that were specially painted to advertise the Borders Railway were the bigger, more modern 170 trains. I get them running to Aberdeen. But they were, I assume, specifically designed for the Borders Railway, yet they're not being used on the Borders Railway. Any comment on that?
It's a 158 operating 3 to 6 train formations respectively. But so I can look at the specific issue if the member wishes, but I'm confident in saying that 158 and class 170 trains are used on the Borders. But notwithstanding that, I still think the Borders and the rolling stock issues on the Borders are not ones that I'm satisfied with, and are we're working to make improvements on them.
Sure. Briefly to say that I think what you're saying to us is fair enough, but I go back to the point that what ScotRail are saying to us, they're giving us the impression that what you're saying to them isn't what you're saying to us. That's all I'm saying.
I don't get that impression at all when I speak to ScotRail. When I speak to ScotRail, and of course if you have ScotRail in front of your committee, I'm sure they would absolutely confirm that they understand the seriousness of which I expect them to take the performance issues that isn't just PPM. PPM is an important contractual obligation, but also capacity issues, also reliability issues, skip stopping, which was mentioned earlier on. These are all issues that I want them to tackle.
I think that it is clear that in the not too distant future, we'll be having to look at this again. So, it is unfortunate there has been a gap in speaking to ScotRail and to the Minister, and to get the two closer together would be more helpful. Neil, I think you wanted some questions.
Yeah, and just my first question, just to follow up on the issue of targets, I think it would be helpful to get some clarification. Phil Vester, the Managing Director of ScotRail, has talked about a PPM of 90.3%, and Minister, in the Chamber on the 22nd of September, in your answer to me, you said the public performance measure target ScotRail barely has is 91.3%. In the franchise agreement, it says in the first day of the fifth franchising year onwards, the PPM target is 92.5%. I think it would be helpful if we can get clarity on what, as it is today, is the PPM target. And also, could we also know a number of targets in the franchise agreement, PPM benchmark tables on improvement plan, performance level, breach performance level, and default performance level are all redacted. It would be helpful if we could get information on what those targets are.
I don't think any of the figures that would be mentioned by the member are incorrect, neither that I gave or indeed where the breach happened. Of course, it has to be reminded that PPM is monitored daily, and the PPM figure, also what we have on top of the PPM figure, of course, is the moving annual average figure, which is often used as well. And some of these I've seen in the press. I'm not accusing the member at all of this, but in the press, journalists have picked one figure and compared it against a different figure. So they've used the MAA figure and compared it to PPM, which isn't the correct way of doing it. But just for clarity on this specific question, you're absolutely right. The contract puts obligations of increased PPM figures to be met by ScotRail, by Obelio. The contract expects a PPM of 91.3 by the end of 16-17. So the railway period is also the end of the financial year. So the PPM is expected to be 91.3. We called for an improvement. I instructed an improvement plan to come forward when the PPM was at 90%. And therefore, if there's a fall of 1% below what the expected PPM is for the contract, that can trigger the improvement plan. So that's why I triggered the improvement plan. That's different to the moving annual average, which of course takes into account what the average was the year before at that specific time period. So that way it's able to take into account, for example, seasonal variations, winter, autumn, which might be different to summer. So that is where we are. I expect that improvement plan to, of course, get ScotRail to that contractually obligated point. In terms of the second point he mentioned, I have hopefully in both in my public statements but also privately to ScotRail made it clear that not only is the performance not at the acceptable standard and neither the contractually obligated standard, but there are some very, very serious consequences if that performance isn't improved. And the member, you know, highlights and alludes to some of those consequences. They have a target for year two, which is 91.3, as I've mentioned. The improvement plan is to get them to within 1%, so that 90.3. If they go down to 87.3, that would be a breach. If they get to the 84.3 level, that's a default. And three consecutive periods of default can result in termination of the contract. Let me make no doubt about that. That is an option that we have. In fairness, I don't suspect it's an option that I'll have to use. I've looked at the improvement plan. I've seen the commitment of the ScotRail team to improve. And I am going to give them that time. Now they've put that performance plan to do that while monitoring on a daily basis how things are improving.
Thank you, Minister, for that answer. You mentioned the improvement plan and the fact you monitor PPM on a daily basis. Obviously, the improvement plan was submitted on the 16th of September, but in the 4 weeks after the improvement plan was submitted, punctuality was actually worse than the 4 weeks prior to the improvement plan submitted. So my question really is, and I think passengers would be keen to know, do you have full confidence in ScotRail and their improvement plan?
Yes, I've got confidence in the improvement plan. I have to give ScotRail the time and the space to enact on that improvement plan, bearing in mind that target of that 91.3 is for 16-17, so the end of that financial year. So I have to give them the time and the space, bearing in mind, and I'm not here at all to excuse ScotRail's performance, I don't find it acceptable, but bearing in mind we are going into that winter period. But the moving annual average seems to be stabilising in the last period at 89.67, as the member alludes to. What it would be fair to say also that the PPM for the current period, we're only 10 days into the current period. Periods are done by every 28 days. We're only 10 days into that this period. But currently, I checked the PPM figures for this period, and they're at 90.6. So, you know, I am going to hold off judgment on how well ScotRail are doing, but I will give them the time, the space, now that they've put forward an improvement plan. But I'd just like to reiterate, if performance worsens, for example, then there are some very serious measures that I can take and I will take if necessary.
You say you have confidence in the plan, but obviously for passengers to have confidence in this plan, they need to know when these improvements are going to happen, similar to the question earlier. And passengers, to take these reassurances seriously, need guarantees.
Yeah.
How will passengers judge the success or failure of this improvement plan? And will the PPM target of 91.3% be met by the end of 16-17? Or will passengers have to wait longer to see the
I don't want passengers to have to wait longer to see improvements. I expect improvements to be starting to be seen on the railways immediately. And so, for example, that's why some of the improvement works are starting and have started already. Let's take capacity as an issue. It's an issue that I frequently get asked about, and as I said, comes up on my social media feed on a regular occasion. I've told ScotRail that they have to, of course, there are medium-term solutions to the capacity in terms of high-speed trains when they come to us later on in the franchise, but there are some immediate improvements that can be made to capacity. and some of what we're doing, for example, on the Glasgow suburban route, 7 new trains will come, 4 already onto the network, and other 3 will come on gradually by the end of 2016. And that will be 1,500 additional seats every day on that very, very packed commuter route. So I'm hoping that some of those improvements will already be seen. Of course, you're absolutely right. There will be some improvements that will be more medium and more long term. And they will see, for example, 23%, almost a quarter more additional capacity by 2019. But I don't expect commuters to have to wait to start to see some of those improvements. Some of those improvements should be seen. But I would like to thank commuters for their patience and their tolerance. But I would say that you know, a PPM figure, having almost 9 out of, or 90 out of the 100 trains coming within 5 minutes of their destination is a figure that, is what we're striving for. But I also accept the point that even if that is the PPM figure, there can still be inconvenience to passengers, even when trains are, for example, 60 seconds late. And I think that's an issue we have to look at as well.
You think they'll hit their PPM figures by the end of this year?
The improvement plan is for 2016-17, so that is when they're expected to hit the PPM. So I expect them to hit by the end of 16-17. That's why the improvement plan is put in place. In terms of ScotRail's own internal targets, that's for them to come up with. I know that they understand the severity of the issue. Fair to say, I mean, you would only have to pick up the newspapers over the last few weeks to see that they are feeling, I'm sure, the heat on this issue. Yes, the target is for the end of 16-17, that period. But I will assess at the end of this year, calendar year, how those improvements are going. And if I'm not satisfied, we'll continue to have very robust discussion with ScotRail.
As Mike Rumble said, we've only seen a summary of the improvement plan that's been published. We've not seen the full improvement plan that was submitted to the government on the 16th of September. So with passengers and the committee can't see the full range of changes that are going to be made. There's been talk about trains being classified as golden trains. We don't know what the golden trains are and what the non-golden trains are. Also, interestingly, following the question from Gail Ross about timetabling changes, there's set to be significant timetable changes. Further to the question from Gail Ross, can you confirm that none of the planned timetable changes will result in longer scheduled journeys for existing services?
No, well, the reason why we make if I'm sure I know what he's talking about. If I'm not addressing the issue, please come back if I'm grasping the wrong issue. But the changes that are being made because of the electrification program that we're taking forward, of course, there's a disruption involved in some of that. What I would say, in the same way that there was disruption, for example, when we had to do necessary work at Queen Street Tunnel. Now, as long as we can communicate when those works are taking place, what effect they'll have on commuters' journeys, and work with commuters to ensure that as much as possible their commuter experience is still a smooth one, then we'll do that. But there is never a convenient time to do works on our railways. Our railways are constantly busy. They're more popular than they ever have been before. So trying to minimise any disruption is absolutely what we'll try to do. In terms of the improvement plan, the key measures that ScotRail are taking place are detailed in that improvement plan. If there are more details that are required, I'm more than happy for the member to write to me, of course, to write to ScotRail directly to ask, for example, the detail of, for example, the golden trains. I want to minimise disruption for our commuters as they travel. I don't want to increase. I don't want them to see any further increase in the disruption to their journey. So I'm very robust in my response to ScotRail in order to see those improvements. Even if the improvement plan is enacted 100% and those targets are met, that doesn't mean that's the end of the story. There are still improvements that have to be made above and beyond the improvement plan to make the commuter journey and the passenger journey a much better experience.
Okay, thank you, Minister, for transparency is very important here, and I think passengers would welcome the additional information around timetabling changes and golden trains and the other proposals. Just finally, Minister, you've told us what's happening is unacceptable. You're aware that 20,000 passengers have signed a petition calling for action on the railways. We've seen trains overcrowded, delays, cancellations. But just 2 years ago, the Scottish Government said this was a world-leading contract. Does the government still believe it's a world-leading contract?
I remember that question was asked at First Minister's Questions and Kezia Dugdale to the First Minister, and I refer the member to her answer because, yes, the ability for us to have a railway that leads on these islands and leads beyond that in terms of the European continent and wider, yes, the contract absolutely has the ability to do that. And what I would say is, yes, there are challenges on the railways and I want to tackle those challenges. I want to improve those challenges, to improve the performance. But what I should say is that the rail revolution, as described by my predecessor, which would take place, of course, when we get those high-speed trains, when we get those longer, faster, greener trains, I think absolutely will be the envy of many commuters. But that doesn't take away from the fact there are major challenges which must be tackled, which I'm focused and determined to tackle, and I know Transport Scotland and indeed ScotRail are looking to do and looking to take on. But I would say that when I look at the passenger survey, the satisfaction with the railways in Scotland is at a greater level than satisfaction, for example, in other parts of the United Kingdom. That doesn't fill me, doesn't satisfy me because I want it to be better than it currently is. I met with those campaigners that he refers to, the 20,000. Obviously, I didn't meet with all of them, but I met with a group of them from 38 Degrees. They told me how the performance issues were affecting their journeys to college, their journeys to their apprenticeship, their businesses. And for me, regardless of if the passenger survey is telling me that it's better than that across the UK, if it's still affecting people in their everyday lives, that to me is an issue. So I'm determined to tackle it. Yes, I believe the franchise, of course, was awarded to Abellio, and they can make I think we can have a railway service that works for the communities and the people of this country and provides a great service. We're not seeing that currently. There are steps that are being put in place, and I'm determined to work with ScotRail and others to better performance on those railways.
I think you've heard from two members of the committee now that they would really like to see the supporting document behind that executive summary, and I think that's a clear request subject to commercial confidentiality, and I'd ask if we could liaise afterwards on how to make sure that's available to the committee. Stuart's got a question, and then we're over to Richard.
Very straightforward, simple question. The Squire system that Transport Scotland has for monitoring a wide range of issues in the network and operation, is that still in use and thought to be of value? Because it was once described as a world-leading monitoring system.
So, we'll answer that question in just a second. In terms of the convener's request and the committee's request, I don't view the improvement plan as a summary document. I view it as the key improvements that ScotRail are wanting to make. While all the information that has been passed to us might not be in that, I'll check the reasons for that. And, of course, I'll liaise with the convener to see what can and cannot be published. But the measures that are highlighted in that document, which has been made public for the first time, of course, they are the key improvements that we expect to see from ScotRail. In terms of the member's point about the Squire monitoring regime, yes, it's still used, and as the member knows only too well, it assesses many criteria, the infrastructure right through to, again, the cleanliness of the toilets and so on and so forth. And where there is a failure to meet those criteria, then, of course, there are financial penalties, and those financial penalties are reinvested back into the railway. So that is still used. What I would say is I had an approach from Kevin Lindsay, ASLEF's main person here in Scotland. He approached me a number of weeks into my role to say that he didn't think the Squire regime was tight enough in terms of auditing when it comes to a second person on a train. And so therefore I gave him an endeavour to see how we could tighten that Squire regime. So we have done that. So I'm always happy to take advice and feedback from all sources about where we can improve our monitoring regime. But it is still a leading auditing and monitoring regime, which has resulted in financial penalties because those very high standards that we expect to be maintained in our railways at times have fallen below that expectation.
Good morning, Minister. We now move from trains to planes.
Stay on trains, if I may, okay, before we move on to planes.
Okay.
Sorry, I thought you were indicating you had a train question.
I thought we were moving on to planes.
Well, we probably will be, but I just wanted to see if there's anything that we can do on trains, because there is one further question which I think is important, considering the publication this morning of headlines saying that the public sector is ready to take over the ScotRail franchise. I'd like to specifically ask what contingency plans does Transport Scotland have in place to provide ScotRail services as operator of last resort, and any possible longer term plans for public sector provision of ScotRail services?
Well, the commitment to enabling a public sector bid was one that we had in our manifesto as a political party, and now the legislative framework is there for that to happen. We are now already in having conversations internally about how we would look to manifest and put in place the structures around that public sector bid. It's something I'm committed to do, and we should have that in place by the time there is a break clause. Not to say that break clause will be enacted, but of course we have to be prepared in that circumstance. What I would say is that we have the operator of last resort here, which would essentially end up being Scottish ministers. There are mechanisms in place in order to take that contract forward if it was terminated early. And so I can give confidence that our railways would continue to run if the contract and if the franchise was terminated before due course. I don't see us going into that territory, as I've said to members already. There's an improvement plan there. I will be looking to see and make sure that improvement plan is enacted upon and we get the necessary PPM figures back up, and we also see improvements in our railway. So we have the option of the operator of last resort. I don't expect me to be running our railways in the near future, but there is a public sector bid that we have committed to facilitating.
So the contingency plans are in place?
Yes.
Are there any other questions on rail? Now, Richard, we move on to aeroplanes.
Thank you very much. Minister, the Scottish Government bought Prestwick Airport for £1, or Glasgow Prestwick Airport. And basically, what I want to ask you is, can you give us an update on the implementation of the Glasgow Prestwick Airport strategy vision, the progress towards returning the airport to profitability, and also eventually to the private sector?
Yes, I can. Thank the member for the question. I mean, it's challenging. There's no two ways about it. What we are committed to doing is getting Glasgow Prestwick back to being profitable and back into the private sector. And so there's a number of avenues that are being pursued on that front. He'll know about some of the work that's been done in our own spaceport. It's an exciting programme. We're waiting for clarification from the UK government, which I'm sure will be coming, in terms of what the licensing regime around spaceport will entail, what capital expenditure will come with that, if any, and so on and so forth. So that discussion is ongoing. So there's a potential in regards to spaceport. Of course, while we're doing that, continue to attract routes, and looking to attract routes to Prestwick, and Ryanair have increased their footprint recently and announced that recently in terms of Prestwick. We also, the member will have noted, an MOU signed between the Scottish Government and the owners of Heathrow when it comes to the expansion. Of course, that announcement yesterday on the expansion or the third runway at Heathrow. Part of that discussion is about basing a logistics hub potentially in Heathrow, which will come with additional jobs. There's also the conversation that's happening between, as has been reported in the press recently, between a high-level international consortium and the owners of Prestwick, looking to secure that work is progressing. And then there's also work that we've done, for example, with Chevron, which is the lease of the hangar, the 747 hangar, again, which will come with jobs to Prestwick. And so we're pursuing commercial opportunities. We're pursuing other opportunities like Spaceport as well. I think there's opportunities there with the Heathrow third runway as well, but it's not to say that it is still not challenging, and it is. So there's a number of avenues that we're pursuing, and as I said, as soon as we are able to return Prestwick back into the private sector and make it commercially profitable, then we will do that.
If there was anyone interested in buying Prestwick, who would they contact in the Scottish Government?
I don't know if that was a direct request from the member, but look, Keith Brown is the Cabinet Secretary who leads
on this. I'm being serious. Someone approached me last week and asked that question. I just want to double check that it is yourself that.
The Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown leads on Prestwick, but of course myself and Keith work very, very closely. So you know, in terms of a government minister, they could of course have discussions. There is a management team at Glasgow Prestwick, and I can furnish the member with the details probably in the first instance with the management team at Glasgow Prestwick.
Thank you.
Minister, if I could just say we have some questions on Heathrow, which we will do just straight after we've done the first bit on Prestwick, if we may. So if I could try and stick to Prestwick at the moment, and I think Gail's got a question for you.
I do. Thanks, Convener. With regards to the strategic, easy for some to say, vision, the capital plan doesn't include the cost of replacing the existing primary radar, which I believe has to be done within the next 5 years. Can you give the committee an indication as to what alternative finance options are currently being investigated?
I will write to the member because I don't have the details very much on the specifics of the radar, but I'll be more than happy to furnish the member with some of the full detail. But she's right in terms of what she said. There's still significant capital investment that's needed for Prestwick, regardless of which route we end up going down, Spaceport or commercial viable airport. And that is being met by the Scottish Government, and we're committed to do that so that we can return Prestwick into a profitable airline. But on the specifics that she asked for in terms of the financing and the radar, I'll furnish her with that information.
Thank you.
Stuart?
I just wanted to ask a question or two about Fifth Freedoms. When Prestwick went into decline in the mid-1970s, it was because the UK government revoked the Fifth Freedoms that allowed Pan Am, KLM and SAS to make intermediate stops at Prestwick, which is what Fifth Freedom is about. Today, I think there are still restrictions in relation to freight, and I wonder if it's possible to check whether Fifth Freedom restrictions are causing a problem. I know, for example, there was freight for a while flying into Prestwick, then being trucked down to Stansted and put on another plane, whereas the plane itself would, of course, be perfectly happy to go all the way and drop off and pick up at Prestwick.
With listening to Stuart Stevenson is always an education, so I will go back and I will check the issue on freight. I'm not aware of the restrictions that he's referring to in terms of Fifth Freedoms, but you know, going back to his the opening remarks, I mean, my parents, for example, have a great emotional attachment to Prestwick. I mean, they came here as immigrants from subcontinent. And Prestwick was the airport, of course, they landed to in Glasgow before Glasgow Airport existed. So, you know, I think people quite rightly have want to see Prestwick be successful, and it's going to have to require a mixture of freight. Of course, the military operations that are there, commercial viability, and indeed any other opportunity will be pursued. But on the specifics that you asked about, again, I will be back in touch with them. But I don't know of that restriction that exists on freight.
Just before we move on to Heathrow, sorry, could you just clarify something for me, Minister? I didn't quite hear your answer. Is did you have a target date for returning Prestwick back to the public sector?
As soon as possible is what I said, Convener.
Okay. I think, unless there's any other questions on that, we'll move on to Heathrow. And I think John has got some questions on Heathrow.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Minister, if I noted you correctly, you said earlier, commendably, we still have work to do on CO2 emissions. And we know that aviation is the fastest source of greenhouse gases. How is the Scottish Government's extreme enthusiasm for a third runway compatible with the aims of the Paris Agreement?
Thanks, the member for the question, and also commend him for pursuing this agenda, as I know he has done over the time. What I said in my opening remarks was that as Transport Minister, I know that I have to make sure me and my department shift our weight when it comes to the very ambitious targets we have in CO2 emissions. Now, what I would say, and it won't be a surprise to the member, is that has to, of course, be a balance to that. Now, a choice was going to be made about airport expansion, Gatwick or third runway at Heathrow. And we chose the Heathrow option and to support the Heathrow option because of the clear benefits to Scotland, not just in terms of the route development, but also because of the additional jobs it will create and also the opportunities for SMEs. What I would say is a couple of things. One is that the airport commissions itself, the studies and the variety of studies that have taken place in terms of the airport commission have shown that Heathrow expansion wouldn't breach EU air quality law or indeed necessarily impact the meeting of carbon targets that the UK have set themselves and international agreements that we've set ourselves, so long as they are offset by other action. And I think that's the key point, that you know, we are ambitious for our airports to secure, for example, long-term routes. And they've had great success in that. Edinburgh and Glasgow, for example, great connectivity to the Middle East. Three carriers now from the Middle East, Qatar, Etihad, and Emirates. We want to, you know, try to see, and the airports want to see penetration into the west coast of America, into the subcontinent, into far, far east as well. Now, we share those ambitions of connecting Scotland globally, but we have to also make sure, if we're doing that, we have to offset it by other measures that ensure that we're helping in that effort to reduce CO2 emissions. So similar to APD cut, which I know, again, the member has set views on. I mean, the APD plans, for example, are subject, as we know, to strategic environmental assessment that will then be published for consultation in 2017. So, you know, realising that everything we do across government has an environmental impact helps us to understand how much we have to offset that in other areas as well. So we have to do some of that. Now, I'm committed as part of the, as one of the members of the subcommittee on climate change, on how transport can do that and mitigate that. Now, we don't know the full effects of the expansion of Heathrow, what that will have in terms of routes to Scotland and wider. That's still going to be up to market competition and discussions as that construction and as the Heathrow as the runway is constructed.
Yeah, Minister, I acknowledge the work that has been done, and there's been good cross-party consensus on climate change. But if it's challenging, and you've acknowledged earlier on that it's challenging at the moment, how much more challenging is it going to be if there's 260,000 additional flights a year? And you've talked about offsetting these measures. Can you give any indication of how these measures will be offset, even of a proportion of what Scotland would do to offset them? Because, of course, this isn't a Scottish issue. It isn't a UK issue, a European issue. This is a global issue. And if we are to meet the challenges of the Paris Agreement, very modest global addition to flying. I mean, you and the Scottish government enthuse about all these additional routes.
What I would say is Scotland's leading from the front, remember. You know, we have those global climate change targets, those leading climate change targets. And in the overall target, you know, the member is aware of the progress that we've made on those overall targets. So we take our leadership and global leadership role very seriously. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't, for example, want to be ambitious. I think there's the ability, and I'm not saying the member's not, of course he is, but I'm saying there's the ability to want our businesses to be globally connected through aviation, but also at the same time ensuring that we meet our commitments. But the member is absolutely correct. This is an international global effort. And I would go back to that Airport Commission study, which said that actually, so long as there's offset measures, then EU air quality wouldn't have to be breached. Now, in terms of the specific question to me, how can we offset? Now, first of all, we have to look at what this Heathrow expansion means for Scottish emissions, because we don't know the full detail of that yet in terms of the additional routes that might be coming to Scotland and some of the Scottish airports. So we'll factor that in as and when those discussions happen. But there's plenty that we're looking to do in terms of transport, from incentivising the private car to be an electric vehicle. So a lot of work going into the incentivisation through the grant schemes that we have, the loan schemes that we have for electric vehicles, right the way through to the work we're doing in terms of making sure our bus fleet, is meeting those Euro 6, are the cleanest engines and low emission vehicles as possible on our buses, right the way through to the work we're doing on ferries. We know of the vessels being procured at Ferguson's commercial shipbuilder are again hybrid in terms of their technology, so cleaner ferry. So right across the transport portfolio, we are ensuring that we're doing what we can to contribute to the reduction of CO2 emissions, and where there are transport initiatives that might increase emissions, as in with the support for Heathrow, then we have to ensure that as a portfolio we work harder to offset those.
There's not been terribly much discussion about the Route Development Fund, the £10 million. Again, that's. Are you able to give any more information on that, where the routes would be developed, additional sites that would be connected to Heathrow?
I mean, it's far too early to say some of that, but what I would say is a couple of the discussions that we've had with Heathrow have been very positive in that they understand we want connectivity with Heathrow, not just for Glasgow and Edinburgh, but we want to see it in airports across the country, and some of those airports like, for example, Dundee, Inverness and others have connections to London, but you know there might be an option there in the future. Sorry?
Others?
I'm saying Inverness, Dundee airports, and so on. They have
any new airports flying to London? Sorry? Would there be any new airports flying to London?
No, those airports fly to London, but we're talking about Heathrow specifically. And so discussions would be for those airports to have. It's far too early a stage at the moment in the discussions about Heathrow to say exactly what slots will be available, exactly what routes. But what we've made clear is in our discussions, we expect Scotland to at the very least proportionately benefit from those new opportunities that exist. In terms of route development and international long-haul route development, I've mentioned some of the markets that I know of that Scottish airports are very keen to attract. Those are the Far East, the subcontinent, and indeed the West Coast of America, where we don't currently have the penetration that we would like to have. But again, we're at very early stages. I would remind the member that construction is not expected until another a few years to begin.
Could I ask about the term short haul? Because it's perhaps I'm just a bit confused and not picked it up correctly, but Mr Brown, the Cabinet Secretary, when he talked, he asserted that additional long haul flights into Scotland could reduce short haul within the UK, but then went on to add that, of course, people flying to Scotland would wish to fly onwards to London Heathrow. So what's the balance there? Because quite clearly, if you've got £10 million to route development, a further incentive of £10 reduction per passenger, there's going to be a significant rise in flights from to and from Scotland.
I think the member's right when he uses the word balance, and that's what we're trying to do as a government. I think there are, you know, people want to be connected to hub airports, Heathrow, Schiphol, Dubai. People want to be connected to these hub airports for a variety of reasons, to visit those cities and then move on to their onward journey, because it gives them a range of other travelling opportunities. So there's a balance between connecting to those hub airports, and Heathrow being one of the world leading hub airports is important, but also being able to attract direct long-haul flights as part of the government's, ambition, and an ambition that's shared with the airports and one that we strive for.
As regards construction at Heathrow, were it to go ahead, there's been some assurances given to the Scottish Government about money coming to Scotland in respect of that. What does that say about the integrity of the procurement process that would apply at Heathrow, Minister?
I think there's opportunities. I mean, it wouldn't surprise the member that when something, construction project of this magnitude takes place, that our interest is to ensure that as many Scottish SMEs would be able to benefit from that. And I don't think anybody would begrudge that. We expect that to still be an open process. But what we'd expect is that Scottish companies, a certain portion of that supply chain, would be ring-fenced for Scotland. That is possible, as far as we're aware, to be done. But within that framework, we can't dictate which Scottish companies must be able to procure and win those contracts. That will be part of an open, competitive tendering process. So, yes, it would be I wouldn't shy away from the fact that we had very robust and long discussions with Heathrow over the opportunities for Scottish SMEs, but I make no apologies for the fact that we managed to secure what we have managed to secure from Heathrow for Scottish companies.
Arthur, one final, if I may.
don't want to interrupt your flow too much, but it's quite helpful if you look at me occasionally, just because there are other people wanting to come in. Please ask another question, and then I'd like to move on to the next person, if I may, John.
That's certainly. Thank you. Sorry, Candida. Yeah, final question on the 16,000 new jobs that's been trumpeted by the Scottish Government, often without mentioning by 2050 and from new capacity. Are you able to give any breakdown at all on how these jobs would be configured and where they would take place, Minister?
It's early phases, but we have, for example, spoken about the fact that we expect the logistics hubs to be based here in Scotland. We've mentioned about the fact of the amount that we expect Scottish companies to be able to procure in terms of the construction and through the supply chain. So there'll be jobs associated with the supply chain. There'll be jobs undoubtedly associated with the addition in terms of long-haul routes, short-haul routes, and the opportunities around that. And I think there'll be job creation also with what we spoke about in terms of Prestwick and the ability for Prestwick to be involved in some of the manufacturing as well. So, no, I don't have an exact breakdown of those 16,000. That comes from the overall picture of jobs that are likely to be created from the Heathrow expansion and a portion of those, as you said, 16,000 of them being realised here in Scotland is a good commitment and one that I think members would welcome.
There, because you had a portion of these 16,000 new jobs.
No. A portion of the overall 280,000 jobs. Oh, sorry, 180,000. I've been corrected.
Okay.
The portion of the 180,000 jobs that have been created as part of the because of the Heathrow expansion. A portion of those, which is the 16,000 figure, which you rightly cite, would be here in Scotland.
I'm grateful for that, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you,
Jamie.
So just a very quick follow-up. You mentioned route development, and it's just a quick supplementary on that. Having sat in meetings with both airlines and airports on proposing new international routes, the feedback that I got very much from those meetings is that it's up to the airport to present the business case to the airline and not the other way around. So I wondered very specifically what measures both the Scottish Government, but you in your capacity in your portfolio, but working with other ministers in the government, are doing to support airports in Scotland to build feasibility studies and robust business cases for new international routes?
Actually, part of why we're keen to, of course, have an APD cut, and obviously the exact mechanisms and natures of that APD cut will be something that will be decided by my colleague, Cabinet Secretary Derek Mackay. But very close conversations happening with the airport and the aviation industry, as you'd imagine, would be a further incentive. But in terms of what the Scottish Government can do, my previous ministerial role was the Minister for Europe and External Affairs. In that, I was involved in many of the discussions around, for example, bringing the Qatar Airways flight to Edinburgh Airport, and met with, for example, the chief exec of Qatar Airways in Doha at the request of Gordon Dewar to see how we could facilitate some of those discussions. But where we can primarily add value is through our agencies. So marketing in terms of Visit Scotland, marketing a route in country is hugely important. I know it was hugely important to Etihad. There was some when we were first having that discussion with bringing Etihad to Edinburgh, the marketing of that route was essential to them. So being able to provide money, which of course has to be state aid compliant, etc., providing that money for marketing is key for airlines. But any other assistance that we can give, that we're able to give, of course, have to be within those legislative boundaries. If we can give any of that support, I have a very good relationship with our airports, so I'd be more than welcome to. I would welcome those conversations about that.
Minister, much of the benefit to Scotland of a third runway at Heathrow is predicated on access to landing and takeoff slots. They are, of course, commercial items bought and sold. In the last 10 years, there was a pair of slots sold for £100 million. There's huge commercial value to these. For Glasgow and Edinburgh, there are train options for travel to London, but for Inverness and Aberdeen, the only realistic travel options to the south and beyond is by connecting at Heathrow. At the moment, we have services there. Although when British Midland were taken over by BA, we saw part of what happened. Virgin ended up with the slots on condition they operated services to Edinburgh and Aberdeen, but it was only for 3 years, and the moment the 3 years were up, the slots were reallocated elsewhere. So there's still a huge value. The new runway will be a short-haul runway of 2,200 metres, not capable of taking big transatlantic planes. Will you continue to press the UK government for one of the planning conditions for the new runway to include dedicated peak time landing and takeoff slots for Inverness and Aberdeen, for whom it is vitally important? Or are there other ways in which we can protect access to slots, not simply for 3 years, 5 years, but in the very long term, because it's vital to those two particular significant airports?
I think the member articulates it better than I possibly could about the importance of trying to secure those slots, but also presents well the challenges, because it is a competitive market, as he's demonstrated by the sale of those two slots that he mentioned. So yes, we're in continual discussions with the UK government about protecting slots for Scottish airports, the ones that he mentions, of course, and others, and those discussions will continue to happen. There's not yet certainty over that, and I think he understands that, but those discussions will continue.
Good. I think we're going to come down to ground now and stop talking about aeroplanes and talk about bicycles and cycling. And John's got a question for you on that.
Thank you, Minister. I'd like to just a brief question, if I may, on the cycling action plan for Scotland, Minister. There's been a lot of commendable progress, and I know there's been some very positive promotion, but Cycling Scotland's second progress report on the plans says that it's going to be very unlikely we're going to achieve the targets by 2020. I wonder, also, it recommends a year-on-year increase in expenditure on cycling till it reaches 10% of national and local transport budget, and a renewed focus on the development of segregated on-street urban cycle infrastructure. As I say, there has been some progress. Can you tell me how you intend to take these recommendations forward, please?
Yes, I would welcome the member's acknowledgement of the progress that's been made, and of course equally commend the Green Party for obviously being pushing this agenda often in Parliament and making sure that it is high up the government's agenda. In particular, the member won't begrudge me for saying his colleague Alison Johnson, I think, played a leading role in some of those conversations. And I would just like to reiterate that we are seeing record investment in active travel. If I can take a couple of the issues that he mentioned in terms of the CAPS review, yes, challenging to meet that 10% vision. And I would say that it's an aspirational vision. I wouldn't like us to scale back on that. I think it's important to have ambitious visions. Now, we have seen some progress on it, again, as the member mentions, and I won't bore him with the statistics as such, but you know, the one statistic I would pull out is that we have seen an increase on journeys that people are taking their bike to work, but not at a level that I think it should be. I think it should be higher than that, and so I wouldn't roll back on the 10% vision. I want us to continue to work towards that 10% vision while recognising challenges. I want us to continue in regards to the investment, and let me give some reassurances on that. At a time where euphemistically we talk about financial constraint, we know that we have an autumn statement due and then a spending review from the Scottish Government on the back of that. We will certainly see what the financial position will be, but I can give him a guarantee that I will fight if there is extra expenditure. I will fight for a portion of that to come to active travel. I think this agenda is hugely, hugely important, and we have to be able to show leadership on that. So that 10% target should maintain. In terms of the 10%, I think he alluded to the 10%, the request from some for 10% of the budget to be allocated towards active travel. I just wish it was as simple as that, but it's not. I mean, we have, because of the various commitments, contractual commitments we have from, you know, the ScotRail franchise, CalMac franchise, dueling of the A9, A96, as well as many, many others, those projects alone in the billions of pounds, and contracted projects for us. It's not simple to just whack off 10% of our budget and say that's going to be spent on active travel. But what I can promise is that record level that he talks about will be maintained through the parliamentary term, where there is an opportunity for me to pull at the purse strings of the former transport minister who now is in charge of the money, then I will certainly make that. And the final point I would make, which he articulated well, was the importance of cycling infrastructure, and in particular segregated cycleways. Now I was delighted to be able to announce the winner of the Community Plus project, the Links Plus project in Glasgow, South City Way. Delighted because it's only 10 minutes away from my house, which of course had no bearing on the decision, but nonetheless a very, very ambitious project. And it is going in the right direction. So I think segregated cycleways are an important part of realising our vision.
Minister, you did talk about the commitments, and these are understood, not least the two duelling projects. We've had representations during a workday to the committee that some modest changes, for instance, to the A96, where the existing system whereby roundabouts are used rather than the more complicated junctions would greatly reduce costs. So obviously, if you could reduce costs on that, you could direct more savings to active travel, such as cycling. Would you undertake to look at that, please?
I'll certainly look at any evidence that's put towards us. If there's any way of saving money, you can bet your bottom dollar that as a government we would try to do that without compromising the integrity, safety, viability of a project. And those are important caveats. So I'm not an engineer, a civil engineer, nor do I have that background. But I have found in this transport job that even when things seem like a simple solution, often they're certainly more complicated. But of course I'd make an undertaking to look at what's been proposed. I think when it comes to major trunk road infrastructure projects, it's important to realise that we do take active travel into consideration. The M8, the M73, M74 being a good example of that in terms of the cycling infrastructure and the walking infrastructure that goes alongside that improvement project. Can we do more? Can we look to do more? I think there's not a reason why we should not explore other avenues when it comes to infrastructure projects. So we're at the early stages of some of these. A96, for example, due to be completed 2030, progressing in terms of the design phase. But if we can supplement more active travel initiatives into those projects, I think we should be open-minded to that.
You mentioned the cycle project near your own home. There's another cycle project on the other side of the city, the Bearsway project in eastern Bartonshire. Obviously, the SNP government have got a policy of promoting cycling in Edinburgh, but the SNP councillors have rejected that particular expansion in eastern Bartonshire. Would you like to comment on that?
Yes, I would say, of course, as the member would be aware, he would be the first one that would rightly be up in arms if I was trying to overturn local authority decisions that were made. So we trust councillors to make the decisions that are pertinent to their local wards and the councils that they represent. But notwithstanding that, and having said that, I think segregated cycleways are a very, very important part of realising our vision of 10% cycle journeys and active travel journeys made by 2020. So what I'm looking to do on the back of not just Bears Way, there's been a couple of examples where I think we could work closer with local authorities to ensure that they help us to realise those very ambitious targets that we have. So, look, while I can't intervene, and I think the member would understand that, I can't intervene in individual local planning decisions, nor would he expect me to do so, I put on record my commitment and my belief that segregated cycleways are an important part to realising our vision, and a commitment to work closer with local authorities to see how we can help to achieve that. And I have the Active Travel Summit coming up in a week's time, and I hope to be able to detail and some, with some more information about how I will look to do that.
We're going to come on to trunk road projects, but just before we do, can we just talk about the National Transport Strategy? And Jamie, I think you've got a question.
Thank you, Convener. I think we've obviously spoken about a large number of different transport means this morning, and I think it's quite apt as we come to close in this that we look at the National Transport Strategy in general. As a committee in one of our off-site days, I think the theme that came up often was that there should be a joined-up approach to transport in Scotland, and I just wondered if we may touch on that. I'd like to ask specifically about the National Transport Review, and if you will confirm that it will be quite comprehensive and all-encompassing and look at a number of different areas concerning transport in Scotland, including things like ticketing, payment methods, including smart cards, but also just looking at how services connect and join up together in terms of how ferries connect to trains, how trains connect to buses and so on. You know, this committee is the connectivity committee as well as the rural economy committee, and I think it's quite important that we stress the importance of rural connectivity as part of this meeting, and the importance that that transport isn't just for getting from A to B, but it is, does have social repercussions in terms of getting and connecting our villages and towns across Scotland. So I just wondered if you would confirm that, but also in detail outline the timetable for that review, and how the public will be able to consult, or how external stakeholders can take part in that review. That would be most helpful.
Yeah, I think the member articulates very well some of the challenges that we face and some of the opportunities that we could realise if we get it right when it comes to the review of the National Transport Strategy. You know, it's a funny thing when you're appointed as a minister, you don't overnight, of course, become an expert in transport. And so my approach has always been to listen to the experts as much as I possibly could, try to gather from them their expertise. And one of the big issues that has come up, and particularly in rural areas, was the connectivity through different modes of transport, as the members just mentioned. So getting off the ferry and then getting a train and then getting a bus to where you need to get to, should be a lot simpler than it currently is. And part of that, I hope, will be the smart ticketing and the rollout of smart ticketing in Aberdeen and Dundee, leading the way in some of that smart ticketing in terms of initiatives. Still a lot of work to do, and I'm committed to the national rollout of that, of course, done in phases. So that will be incredibly important. What I would also do is stress exactly what the member has said. There's a reason why I, as a junior minister, sit under the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Connectivity and Fergus Ewing. Some people might have thought my job might more pertain to, for example, infrastructure, and there's an element of that, of course, and I also have a close relationship with Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown, but there's a very deliberate reason why I'm under Fergus Ewing and his Cabinet Secretariat, and indeed this committee, because we realise how important transport is to rural connectivity, as well as the other connectivity issues in that portfolio. In terms of the specific question in regards to the review, yes, I can give an undertaking that this will be as wide scoping a review as possible, a real meaty review. That's why it will be over a period of 2 to 3 years. I haven't detailed the time scales, and we're still having those conversations, but I would welcome feedback, of course, from members. But the reason why it's going to be throughout the parliamentary term, as I've said, is because I need it to be detailed. Could I do a review within 12 months? I'm sure we probably could, but it's not something I would like to do at all, because it wouldn't be comprehensive at all. It's got to require engagement. Every meeting I go to, people give me ideas of what should be in that National Transport Strategy review. Now, can I encompass them all? Probably not. But can I try to take as many of those transport priorities with us as part of the review as possible? I'll absolutely do that. So it'll be important to do that from a sectoral point of view, but also from a geographical point of view as well. So the period between now and spring 2017 is almost the pre-engagement that we're doing before the actual engagement as part of the review takes place. So as I say, I'm already meeting with stakeholders, both passengers and commuters, and also those that are operating our transport operators, as well as actually regional transport partnerships, leaders of councils, and so on and so forth. I'm meeting with all of these to try all these individuals and organisations to see what their priorities are and to hear from them. But if the member ever wishes to have a sit down session with me about what he thinks some of the priorities should be, then I'm more than welcome. I would more than welcome that.
I'm very grateful to the minister, and I'm sure some of us would be very happy to do that. Very selfishly, if I could ask a short question, you may be aware that the reports that Troon is bidding for the Iron Ferry to replace their Drossan route. Do you have a view on that?
Yes, I do, and I've made that view made publicly. Of course, we continue the work that we do with the Drossan Task Force. A good amount of work has been done. But it would be an abdication of my responsibility if I didn't look at every single option that came towards me and came to my table. So I've had South Ayrshire Council as well as Associated British Ports make that approach. I've had North Ayrshire Council, of course, and Peel Ports, who are the owners of Drossan, come to me to say that the ferry should stay at Drossan. I've also been to Arran. I met with the
the various organisations and community groups and business forums, as well as had elected members from John Scott right the way through to Kenny Gibson, approach me about why they think the ferry should go from their terminal. What I'm saying at the moment is I'm not closed-minded. I do realise the significant challenges, but also the opportunities that route can present as well. So the Adrossan Task Force work will continue. You know, Adrossan is the port, remains the port, but it would be remiss of me not to give consideration to other options that come under my nose.
I think Richard's got a brief one. Richard, I just...
Here, Minister, on Monday I was asked by a senior citizen who has a travel pass why they can't use it on the trams in Edinburgh. Can you answer that question, or can you get back to me on that one?
Yes, I'll get back to you on that one. Though I think, I'm trying to remember, I think I have some correspondence from you. If it's not from you, then it's perhaps from another MSP on that specific point. So it is something that we're looking at in terms of the National Travel Concessionary Scheme, and it is something that's constantly under review. Yeah.
Let more people go on the trams. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. John.
Just a quick follow-up. Minister, if I can, you mentioned smart cards. I mean, I think there has been some concern that Strathclyde might go off and do its own thing and the rest of the country do something else. Are we happy about that?
I wouldn't be happy if that was the case, but I had a conversation with SPT senior management a couple of weeks ago, and again, without putting words into their mouth, they understand the vision that we have for a national smart card to be rolled out. There are some discussions about the e-purse that is used. But I have to say my discussions with SPT were constructive, and I hope to continue them in that constructive manner. So yes, it would be a source of frustration for me if there was a separate, it wouldn't make any sense really if there was a separate system in one part of the country and a different system in other parts of the country. But that wasn't quite the intimation from SPT. So the dialogue is constructive.
We're going to move on to major trunk road projects, and there are two specific questions in specific areas. If I ask Alexander to lead on the first one, please.
Thank you, Minister. It's about the AWPR. And it's good to see progress going on up there and experiencing the improvements at Dice personally the other day. However, we've had a number of issues caused by contractors all around the route, ranging from watercourse pollution, runoff, flooding, damage to dikes and fencing, other environmental damage. I know SEPA have got concerns over it, and they have raised an enforcement notice. Certainly the residents and people affected by it have ongoing concerns. I just wonder what if the Minister would like to comment on that, what he's doing about it, and whether he'd like to respond. I think they've requested to meet with him, whether he could give a response to that as well.
Thank the member, and you know, it's an important thing to say about AWPR, of course, is that we're still scheduled to open at the date of winter 2017. He understands that the real benefits that will make to the communities that he represents as well. So it's a project we're rightly proud of. Every transport and every infrastructure project, of course, comes with its complications, and he mentioned some of those there. Some of them can be with the appropriate amount of foresight, you know, we can mitigate those. Some come as the construction phase goes on, so he's mentioned some of those, and I'm more than happy to give him a nod in terms of what we're doing to mitigate the very specific measures he mentions, but in terms of meeting, I have no problem with doing that, so I'm more than happy to discuss that with the member, to meet as a local groups, or indeed to meet with wider stakeholders to hear their concerns. Generally what I hear about the AWPR is fairly positive. There are some things that we're keeping an eye on as well, but no, more than happy to meet with the appropriate stakeholders.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Richard, last time I gave you the floor on this subject, it was quite a long time, and I'm very conscious the Minister has given a lot of his time.
Be brief, but, you know, the Minister, when he started his statement, said we're spending over £1 billion in roads. You're actually spending £500 million of that billion in my area or areas beside me. Can you give us an update, a brief progress update on the M8, M74, M73, A725 upgrade? And can I also thank you for allowing me to visit with you these areas a few weeks ago.
No, I was delighted that you were able to join me again. A project that will have great and significant impacts on that travel between Glasgow to Edinburgh and indeed some of the surrounding towns, villages as well. The impact on local residents, I would like to thank them for their forbearance. A construction project, inevitably leads, unfortunately, to disruption. I think the residents in your constituency and indeed other constituencies that have been affected, my personal thanks to them for their forbearance and their patience, and that as somebody who uses that route himself. So my thanks, first of all, to them for that. Secondly, my thanks to those who are working on the project. We're still due to open in spring 17, as he saw when he was visiting the project with me. That visit was particularly enlightening to me because, again, the member will have seen that a large portion of that workforce are EU citizens, and again demonstrated the importance that the EU citizens, in terms of the contribution that they bring. So we're on budget and on time, which is the two things that any transport minister wants of infrastructure projects. So that's good. So making good progress certainly on that. But where there are issues, again, I'm open-minded to hearing them from members or for indeed groups and organisations in the community.
Well, I'm very happy for you to say that. I'm in constant dialogue with SRP, Scottish Roads Partnership, and also Transport Scotland in regards to acoustic barrier fencing. I was told that none would be constructed yet as we go along the M8. We now have outside Maxim Park, Dakota Hotel, 300 yards away from it, past the Bell Bridge, 300 yards away from the properties possibly affected, on the A725, a quarter of a mile away from the properties affected. But I'm still not getting an answer why we are not. That's all on the M8. On the M74, the only acoustic barrier fencing that's been erected is by new developers who are putting up new houses. But at the rear of Burnacre Gardens, which is right on top of a hill, the M74 is down here, and Burnacre Gardens is a number of yards up. So 10 yards away, I'm not getting acoustic barrier fencing. I've sent you something like 10 letters in the last couple of weeks. That's maybe the letters you're thinking of. I still have no answer to this.
I'll certainly get him an answer, of course, as you'd imagine, to the correspondence that he sent. There are thresholds that determine where noise barriers and where noise mitigation measures should be implemented. And if noise level rises, by one decibel, then those noise above those thresholds, then of course the noise barriers are then provided. So there are thresholds that exist. And what I would say to the member is also that there is ongoing monitoring. So after 1 year in terms of the construction, the opening of the project, there'll be ongoing monitoring at a one-year period, at a five-year period, at a 10-year period, and at a 15-year period. So there are opportunities, even if mitigation and noise barriers, noise mitigation measures are not there, not in place, there are opportunities through after that for them. But I must emphasise the point that is if thresholds are breached, then mitigation is required. So the exact examples that he gave, I'll go back and look at them, but the likelihood is that because thresholds were breached, that's why mitigation was put there. Now if he, as he seems to be indicating, if he believes that not to be the case, then I can provide him with, and look to provide him with some of the data and the statistics around that.
I'll pose my last question. And you gave a commitment a few minutes ago to visit an area in Aberdeen. Where my area is 37 miles down the road from this place. I'm asking you visit with me. You gave an original commitment to me to visit St John the Baptist Primary School, the only primary school in Scotland that I know that runs parallel to a major motorway. I was given that commitment, you would visit it. That commitment was then rescinded, not by you. I'm asking for a commitment that you will visit Burnacre Gardens and St John the Baptist Primary School with me in order to highlight the problems that have been highlighted to me. And I'll finish, Chair, convener, by saying, Scottish Road Partnership say, we'll give you a better quality of life for road users and local communities. The people who stay at Burnacre Gardens and the pupils who use the St John the Baptist Primary School are not getting a better quality of life. They're getting more noise.
Before you answer the question, we have got a long way to go, and I very, very much appreciate that this is an area that Richard feels passionate about. So I think a simple undertaking that you'd be prepared to visit with him and look at the site would be extremely helpful in us expediting the rest of the business that we have in front of us.
Okay, in that case, yes, of course, any visit with my colleague Dick Lyle is one that I would be happy to take up.
Thank you very much, Minister. I would like to ask John a question. John's got some questions on the accessible transport plan.
Maybe keep it to one, seeing where time, I think, is probably against us. But yes, the accessible transport framework, and just really the whole issue of accessibility to transport. I mean, I see stations being improved with ramps and things, which is great. But I see others where not a lot is happening. I think most of us accept Glasgow Subway will never be fully accessible. And some people feel that, say, Waverley, since it was upgraded, has become less accessible for people than it was before. So I suppose I'm just looking for a commitment on accessibility to public transport. I know it's not going to be overnight, but is it a priority for yourself?
Huge priority, and you're right, it won't be overnight. The accessible travel framework is a 10-year framework, but the important part of the framework is that it was designed by those with disabilities for those with disabilities. And I have to confess to the member, I was pretty shocked at some of the testimonials I heard from people when we were doing the launch. Unacceptable situation where those with a physical disability, for example, were shuffling on their backside downstairs in the middle of a busy railway station because the lift was broken and nobody had told them that the lift was going to be broken. So to get to a job opportunity, having to do that, lack of dignity being imposed upon them because the suitable facilities weren't in place is an unacceptable situation. So lots of measures in that accessible travel framework. I'm very proud of it. But I'll only be continue to be proud of it if it actually realises changes on the ground, which we're very, very committed to doing.
Okay, leave it at that.
Thank you, Minister. The final area that we're going on to now is the Lawrence Kirk Junction. And there's two members with questions on this. I'm sure the Minister's well aware of the background to this petition that has been ongoing on and off, I think, since 2005, looking back to the papers. And it would be very helpful for the committee if you could give some undertakings to the people who are going to ask the questions, so that when we come to consider the petitions after your evidence to the committee, we have a clear understanding of your position on it. So I think Murray's sat very quietly and is ready to speak on that.
Thank you, Convener. The last issue we're going to look at today, but by no means the least, and I know that the Minister's aware that this has been a very long ongoing issue in my constituency, and I very much welcomed the announcement earlier this year, and I believe that that was in part due to all the hard work that was done by the petitioner, Jill Fotheringham, whose petition we will be hearing next, as the convener mentioned, but also MSPs. I know that Mike's campaigned on this, as well as my predecessor, Nigel Dawn, and both Aberdeenshire and Angus councils have worked hard on this as well, because initially there, of course, the safety concerns are ongoing, but it's also significantly inhibited development in both Aberdeenshire and in Angus. But in spite of the announcements that have been made by government, and I did ask a parliamentary question about this back in June, I think there's still a lot of concern by my constituents and people living in the area that there is a fear that it still may not go ahead and they're not too sure exactly of the plan. So can I ask the Minister today for that categorical assurance for the people in my constituency that the junction will be going ahead? And if you can also give an idea of the timescales, when that can be delivered and where the plans are currently sitting at the moment.
Yes, I can give a confirmation that the grade separation at Lawrence Kirk is something that we've not only committed to, but of course announced the £24 million for the design and the construction of that. So putting our money where our mouth is. So that's incredibly important for us for all the reasons that the member has articulated better than I can possibly articulate. And I just want to join her in thanking campaigners like Jill Fotheringham, like those other MSPs that she's mentioned from across the political divide, who have pushed this agenda, much needed grade separation at Lawrence Kirk. So for their efforts. In terms of where we are, she may have seen that we appointed design consultants in September, which means we're now stepping up the work to deliver this much-needed scheme. There's still a lot of work to be done, as, again, she'll be familiar with. What I will look to do, instead of going through it, I'm conscious of time, what I'll do is I'll ask my colleagues to write to her and any other member that has an interest about what the general process is when it comes to infrastructure projects, bearing in mind that many of the members here are new members, new MSPs, or indeed would just like that information. What I can do is start to go through. Now, what I can't do, and I have to just emphasise this, is give you an exact timescale of when that will take place. The reason for that is because within the statutory process, if there are, for example, objections to a certain route and sorry, a certain part of the scheme, then there may well be need for further consultation, further discussion, local inquiries, and so on and so forth. So I couldn't tie us down to an exact timescale on that. But what I can do is get her the process by which a major infrastructure project like Lawrence Kirk, what the process is it has to go through.
Could I ask you to get your officials to direct that information through our clerks in the committee, so I can make sure it comes out to the committee members. And I think what would help Murray is that understand that there are processes, and it, if there are objectors, it delays. I think what would be helpful for all concerned is some target dates, subject to a fair wind of when they can see shovels on the ground. And one understands, and I think that everyone in the committee and everyone's realistic enough that there is a process to go through and there are knock-on effects if it does. But that would be very helpful, and I would ask if that could come to the clerks. Do you want to follow up on that?
Yeah, I'm going to ask exactly that, just to give the sort of indicative timescales, providing there were no objections, because I do completely understand that objections can delay these projects by a number of years, depending on the nature. But I would also ask the Minister that ask if the Government are taking a strategic look at road and rail in the Angus North and Mearns area, particularly because we have a lot of major developments happening with Montrose South Regeneration. The port is doing incredibly well there too, and we have the planned investment from GSK. And so there is huge growth potential there, and it's just to ensure that that is being looked at.
Dates, of course, convener, I will put those through the clerk of the committee, and you know, all going well, target for the draft orders would be 2019, but again, I'm you know, reluctant to nail that to the mast because of the various as I said, there could be objections and other such things as well. So I will feed that information through the committee and the convener as appropriate. In terms of the wider transport issues in the area, there's a few opportunities. There's a review of the National Transport Strategy. There's also what will follow from that will be the review of the Strategic Transport Projects Review, the STPR, which is a document which pertains to the major infrastructure projects on our trunk roads that we look to do. So there's an opportunity there as well. And then, of course, there's conversations which are very, very early stages, which are happening with the local authorities in that area about potential city deals and region deals as well. So there are opportunities that I think, if the member wishes to feed into, that we can look at you know, the infrastructure and the transport needs of the area that she represents.
Mark, you would like to...
First of all, say that this whole issue of the campaign for the grade separated junction at Lawrence Kirk, it was never a party political issue. I wanted to put on record the support I got as a local constituency member at the time for all the regional members who also supported the group. So it's only about saving lives, this issue. But I have to say that we are exactly the same position as we were in 11 years ago. And Jill Fotheringham, who was Campbell at the time, that's why the names have changed. The first petition was, we got an agreement from one of your predecessors at the time, Nicol Stephen, as Transport Minister, that the Great Separated Junction would be the very next junction built after the 4-foot one was completed, when we had a 50-mile-an-hour and speed camera at 4-foot. The 50-mile-an-hour zone was only meant to be a temporary measure with a speed camera at Lawrence Kirk until that Great Separated Junction was built. That temporary measure was put in 11 years ago, and her petition was dropped. I don't want to go into details, but other transport ministers then decided that actually there wasn't a programme there and that there was no commitment to start the project. And that's what prompted her to relaunch the petition in 2009. and we're exactly in the same position, what would be immensely helpful, and we are all understanding the issues of when a project starts, what can delay it, but the key issue here is not the end date. The key issue is for you to give the green light to the go-ahead start date. That's what we're all holding our breath for in the Northeast on this issue. If you could just give a commitment to a start date, that would be tremendously helpful.
I hear what the member and Mary had said previously, and not coming from the area, you're well able to represent and articulate the feelings of the local community. That they, what they don't want is another false dawn, only for the project to be pulled. So let me feed that information as I endeavour to do through the convener. There are, as I said, target date for draft orders in 2019, but let me see if I can, with all the caveats, please, if I may emphasise that point, with all the caveats that you well understand, let me see if I can put in some information, because you're absolutely right. If people have seen false starts before, then I can see why there might be some scepticism. But I hope the fact that we've made a commitment in terms of the finances involved in this as well, and the fact that we've, of course, design consultants have been appointed, that gives people some reassurance. But I accept what the member says.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'm sure you will not be held absolutely to the dates. But we look forward to getting that information. Just before we finish, I'd ask if there are any, if there's a statement you'd like to make to close the session before I've got a few things to say, if I may.
Thank you very much, convener. I found this a very valuable session indeed. Covered a lot of the portfolio. There's a number of things that I've endeavoured to get back to, and of course my officials have taken note. I'm always here to be able to take feedback, questions. But let me just reiterate on the issue where we spent a significant amount of time, that I want to see improvements in our transport, particularly the current and in my immediate priority is to see those improvements on our railway network. They're not an acceptable standard. I will continue to work with all the stakeholders, primarily ScotRail, but also our passengers and commuters, to see and to realise some of those improvements. But there's lots of issues for me here to consider, and of course open to coming to the committee any time the convener and committee members wish me to do so.
Well, I'd like to thank you, Minister, and your officials coming with you. You seem to have been able to answer all the questions with only a few notes passed along the chain, but I thank them for attending. There are issues that we have asked for further information on, And I'm grateful that you said you'll supply them. The clerks will be in contact with your department to make sure that we get those information and we work together on it. Yesterday, when we met in the corridor, you said you were looking forward to coming to the committee. I said I hoped you weren't looking forward too much. You've been here for 2.25 hours. I thank you very much for your time, and we will take you up on the offer to follow the developments of the issues we've raised today at a later date. So thank you very much. There'll be a short pause now while we allow the witnesses to go.
Bathroom stop.
Bathroom stop for those that need it. I'm sorry, I was just going to reconvene the meeting. The second item on the agenda are public petitions. And there are two public petitions. The first one the committee will consider is P1236 by Jill Fotheringham on the A90 to A937 safety improvements. The petition was previously considered by the Public Petitions Committee and Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. The Transport Minister has given us an update on the Lawrence Kirk Junction, and I could turn you to the papers that support this, but in light of what the Transport Minister has said to me, and until we have the further information that he has volunteered to let us have, it would seem appropriate for me to suggest to the committee that we allow the petition to remain open and consider it once the minister has given us that information. Does anyone have any comments they want to make on that?
Right. Agree with that, because like what Mike said before about the previous petition, I think when that had been closed expecting that there would be other developments, I think until we see it progress a bit further, get that extra information from the Minister, I think it's important that we keep the petition open.
Okay, so can I take it that we're agreed that we will keep the petition open?
Yeah.
Thank you. The second petition is the committee's first consideration of P1598 by Guy Lindley Adams on behalf of the Salmon and Trout Conservation Scotland. There is a paper providing details of the previous consideration by the petition, by the Public Petitions Committee, for your consideration. I would like to invite comments. I will want to make a comment on this, and I would like to remind members of my declaration of interest that I am involved in wild fisheries. Stuart.
I think it is an important issue, and the important thing probably that we need to understand on the back of this is what the Scottish Government's position is on all this. It's all very well, you know, we've a lot's gone on, we've got SEPA's position, we've got various people's position, but I think the important thing is to know what the Scottish Government's position is, and I would suggest that the next step is that we ask them for that, and until we receive that, that we keep the petition open.
Does anyone have a contrary view to that, or can I take it that you will support that view, that we write to the Cabinet Secretary and ask his opinion and to give us further advice on this matter, and in the meantime the petition remains open?
Mm-hmm. Just a quick question. It's yes. More on a procedural thing, and that's if SEPA, and I believe from reading the notes, that they identify that this is a matter of animal welfare rather than environment, what the implications that will have on any other similar case that comes up, not just salmon lice, but, you know, puppy farming, for example, well, that's an animal welfare issue rather than environmental. So where are we setting a precedent by acknowledging receipt of this?
Well, I think that there's two sides to it. I think that there's the side that the wild fish will actually are being affected, and also the cage salmon, but in this particular case, it's the wild fish as a result of the farming of the salmon.
So by default then, if because this involves a natural wild animal as opposed to a commercial venture, that's where we cross the line.
But the cause of the problem lies within the committee's remit. Aquaculture actually falls within the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, which is why it's before us. You're happy with the answer? Okay, so we all agreed that we write to the Minister and ask for further information on this subject. Right, that concludes today's business, and what I'd like to do very briefly is to go into an informal closed session just to explain to you about the couple of meetings that I had yesterday. It will take no more than 5 minutes, but I'd like to conclude the meeting at that stage. Thank you very much.